Mr. President, I rise today to share my support for the Comprehensive Addiction and Recovery Act of 2015. This legislation, of course, that we've been debating for well over a week now, aims to address the growing drug addiction crisis facing our country by not only promoting prevention and education, but by increasing efforts to improve treatment and recovery for those who have fallen to this growing epidemic. The Centers for Disease Control and Prevention found that from 2002 to 2013, the number of heroin-related overdose deaths nearly quadrupled, with approximately 8,200 deaths in 2013. The CDC furthermore found that 44 people die every day due to prescription drug overdoses. The National Institute on Drug Abuse estimates that the abuse of alcohol, illegal drugs, and tobacco cost the United States roughly $700 billion every year because of increased criminal activity, loss of employment, and health care costs associated with drug use. And Colorado, unfortunately, is no exception to the increase in drug overdose deaths. The Centers for Disease Control and Prevention reports that drug overdose deaths in Colorado has risen in every single county, except for one, over the last 12 years. The Colorado Health Institute found that Colorado's 2014 rate of 16.3 drug-related deaths per 100,000 people exceeded the U.S. average of 14.7 deaths per 100,000 residents. The same study by the Colorado Health Institute found that drug overdose deaths climbed 68% in Colorado between 2002 and 2014, a 68% increase in drug overdose deaths in 12 years. The National Institute on Alcohol Abuse and Alcoholism found that nearly 23 million adults in the United States have struggled with drug use. However, the National Institutes of Health found that only 10% of U.S. adults who need treatment are receiving it. So only 2.3 million people out of the 23 million they've identified with some kind of a drug use problem, only 10%, 2.3 million out of the 23 are receiving some kind of treatment. And so what are we going to do to move forward from here? Because we're on an unsustainable path when it comes to addiction and to its treatment. So it's imperative that states are empowered with the resources needed to address the unique needs of each individual state. And the Comprehensive Addiction and Recovery Act does just that. The bill leaves behind the sort of idea that a one-size-fits-all program out of Washington, D.C. can fix everything. It encourages states to develop their own strategies because what works in Colorado may not work in New Jersey. What works in New York may not work in Texas or California. It encourages these strategies to prevent, treat, and reduce the growing epidemic, the growing addiction epidemic, by first, number one, creating an interagency task force to develop best practices for prescribing pain medication and pain management. The CDC found in a national survey on drug use and health conducted from 2011 to 2013 that individuals addicted to opiate painkillers are 40 times more likely to be addicted to heroin. The Centers for Disease Control and Prevention found that in 2012, healthcare providers wrote 259 million prescriptions for opiate pain relievers. That's nearly one bottle of pills for every single American. And certainly every single American adult. Absolutely imperative that the best practices are established to ensure health professionals are being trained properly to identify patients who require prescription pain relievers for chronic pain management and those who do not, to create this system better identifying them. The consequences of this addiction, we've seen it in our communities, are devastating to individuals and to families, and it's vital that states establish best practices to minimize the devastating effects that our communities have seen, our families have seen. Secondly, this bill expands disposal sites for unwanted prescription medications. Community pharmaceutical drug take-backs, as they're called, take-back programs, allow individuals to dispose of unwanted or expired medications in a safe and responsible way. Many households in our country, they don't safely and securely store unused pharmaceuticals medication, leaving open the door for abuse by teenagers and young adults who might find this, the prescription drugs, the unused or expired pharmaceuticals, they might find them in the house still. According to the CDC, the abuse of prescription drugs has become the second leading cause of death among individuals between the ages of 25 to 64. Furthermore, the abuse is strongly linked to heroin addiction. According to the Drug Enforcement Administration, 4 of 5 new heroin users started with prescription medications. And unfortunately, the vast majority of medication take-back programs in Colorado are in the Denver metro area. But we're not just simply dealing with a metro problem. Getting unused drugs out of communities eliminates the potential for misuse and drastically decreases the potential for addiction. And the expansion of these programs is a step in the right direction to help reduce the accessibility of dangerous prescription medication, especially in rural Colorado. Third, this legislation also aims to identify and to treat incarcerated individuals that suffer from addiction by implementing medication-assisted treatment programs for use by criminal justice agencies. Our statistics show that imprisonment has a very small impact on future drug abuse when addiction goes untreated. The National Association of Drug Court Professionals found that roughly 95% of those who have committed drug-related crimes return to drug abuse after release from prison. We know that addiction is treatable, and it's important that these individuals have access to addiction and recovery services so that they don't continue in the cycle in and out of our nation's prisons. I'd like to share a success story from an adult recovery program in the Denver area about a young woman who went to a treatment facility that turned her life around. I'm not using her real name, but Sarah was admitted to our program, the program in Denver, in September of 2015. Outside of the first week, she has been clean and sober. Sarah found a job and received positive performance reports, and she received a raise at the employment where she had sought after the treatment. She worked to find additional volunteer work to do in her spare time as a way to give back to the community that was now taking care of her through these treatment programs. She's reconnected with her family. And every holiday, since she started this program, Sarah reports that it's the first time she can remember being sober for that holiday. She reports that she's loving her life and that there's no turning back for her. And so this bill will create more of these stories, the success stories, to help people get back on their feet, to reconnect with their families, to engage in community service, to receive raises at work because they do a good job when they can make sure their addiction is broken. Fourth, the Comprehensive Addiction and Recovery Act takes a step in the right direction by strengthening prescription drug monitoring programs aimed to identify and treat drug-seeking individuals. State electronic databases that collect data on substances dispensed throughout the state have been incredibly effective at tracking the movement of prescription opiates throughout the country. Utilizing these programs allows states to identify drug diversion, prescription drug fraud, doctor shopping, and forgeries. Prescription drug monitoring programs also identify drug-seeking individuals more easily to get them into treatment facilities so that they can receive the care they needed, just like Sarah had received in Denver. Tracking and minimizing drug diversion is absolutely vital, and this legislation takes a step in the right direction to address this critical need. So, as we talk about this legislation, I think it's important that the stories that have been told on the Senate floor about what's happened to friends, family members, about drug overdose, opiate abuse, heroin addiction, the fact that we have this doctor shopping, the fact that we have forgeries of prescriptions or perhaps just unused drugs sitting around somebody's house without a take-back program, improper ways to dispose of it mean that teenagers and young adults are getting their hands on it. But we recognize in these stories that it's not just the metro areas, not just our urban centers that are facing these challenges. In fact, it was recently reported in the Denver Post under a headline, "Drug Overdose Deaths Hit Record Levels in Rural Southern Colorado." The comments in here from the San Luis Valley Behavioral Health Group. The San Luis Valley, of course, is in southwestern Colorado, well, the western slope of Colorado in the San Luis Valley. "We are getting more referrals for heroin along with prescription drug abuse," said Christina Daniel, the chief operating officer of the Behavioral Health Group. "We have a need for services for sure in our area." Among Colorado counties, the most striking increase in drug deaths occurred in Baca County. This is in the southeast part of the state, an agricultural community bordering the presiding officer's home state of Oklahoma. Talking about the death rate that quintupled in 12 years. This is a small rural community bordering both Kansas and Oklahoma in the corner of our state that has seen a rural community that had seen its death rates quintuple in 12 years. And the amount of hardship that is placed on families, on friends, and is unimaginable, unacceptable. And with this legislation, we can help work through these challenges, to overcome these challenges, and to indeed start putting an end to the tragedies that we've talked about now for this past week. Because this is an epidemic in our country. Drug overdose, heroin, opiate abuse. It doesn't discriminate between race, gender, or socioeconomic status. It's hit some of the most unsuspecting parts of our country. I'm proud to join my colleagues in support of this broadly bipartisan legislation, and I've certainly heard overwhelming support from my constituency in Colorado. Everyone, from local law enforcement families, victims of professional addiction and recovery specialists, and mental health providers have joined together to voice their support. And I would like to commend my colleagues, Senators Portman and Ayotte, for their extensive efforts to advocate on behalf of those who do not have a voice. I'm proud to join my colleagues, and I urge the Senate to support this legislation.